point, which is mutation. Mutations happening to the cells. So, coming to the remedies of cancer. So, the first thing is to prevent cancer from occurring. That is the best thing. Okay, because cancer is a multi-step process. Okay, it has different steps. First is initiation, then promotion, then progression. So we can stop this development to a fully developed cancer by preventing either the initiation step or the promotion step, because it takes a lot of time to get a cancer converted, a fully developed cancer to a fatal disease. Okay, so it is better to prevent the cancer from occurring. And another thing is that 80% of the cancer occurring are environmental cancers. Okay, so due to different reasons, so it can be really prevented. And only 20% are hereditary cancers. So, to prevent cancer, one is chemo prevention. Chemo prevention using different plant products. Okay, either initiation or promotion or progression steps can be prevented using natural products or non-toxic compounds. This is called chemo prevention. And another thing is the change in lifestyle. That means we should, if I told you it is 80% is due to environmental factors, so stop exposure to that environmental factor. That is the change in lifestyle. Okay. So then the next one is, if cancer is already occurred, then the only thing we can do is therapy. There are different therapeutic options for the treatment of cancer. First one is surgery. If you can remove that part of that affected area, that is the best thing. Okay. So not all organs can be removed like that, but if it is a removable part, it is always preferred to do the surgery. Then chemotherapy. If it is essential that we should maintain that part there, then we should do a chemotherapy. That means treatment of cancer using chemicals. Then radiation. Radiation also can be done on the affected area. Of course, there is the possibility of normal cells also get affected.
Hello?
Hello? Okay. So then radiation, then immunotherapy, then and hormone therapy, stem cell transplantation, all these treatment modalities also are used for the treatment of cancer. And chemotherapy, as I told, it uses drugs to treat cancer cells, and chemo prevention is blocking the cancer at any stage of its progression. So coming to natural chemo preventives, this is curcumin, then resveratrol isolated from grapes. Then this is the plant called Lakshmi Taru. So people are telling that there are some chemo preventive effect for this plant. I don't know actually, but there are several reports like that. Then EGCG, epigallocatechin gallate. It is a compound isolate from green tea. This is this official list. Then this is, I forgot the name of the plant. So these are different plants, and almost all these plants has the, some compounds which can prevent the occurrence of cancer. The Malayalam, it is, this plant is called Agathi Chira. I forgot its English name. So chemo prevention, as I told, it is a multi-step process, the process of carcinogenesis. So first one, this is a normal cell. So benzopyrene is a carcinogen. Carcinogen means a compound which can induce cancer. Okay, so benzopyrene is a carcinogen present in cigarette smoke and deep fried food. Okay, so it can induce DNA damage, that is mutation. Okay, so that is an initiation process. Just because a cell is initiated, you may not get cancer. Most of us will be initiated in one step or another step because due to some environmental factors such as, you know, smoke. We are getting exposed to so many carcinogens. So we will be initiated. So that is this is an irreversible process. Okay, once you are initiated, you can never reverse this process, but you can block it here. Okay, at this step, you can stop it. That is there are some compound which can do that. They are called initiation blockers. Then, so once it is damaged, it is a mutated cell now. Okay, then this mutated cell can go to the next step. It will divide into different, so many mutated cells so that you will get a tumor, a small tumor. This is the promotion step. This step can prevent this development of this initiated cell to promoted tumor. Okay. There are most of the plant products are like this. They stop the promotion step. Then next step is you will get angiogenesis, means development of blood vessels around this tumor, and it will start invading neighboring tissues, and it will move from that origin state of origin plus to other distant organs. So this is progression. This step also can be prevented by some of the plant products. So this is the multi-step carcinogenesis step. So you can the chemo prevention works like this. It can block here, it can block here, and it can block here. So these are the some of the compounds isolated from different plants. This is curcumin isolated from turmeric. This is capsaicin. It is isolated from red chili. This is gingerol isolated from ginger. Green tea, EGCG. Then genistein, soybean. So many things. Okay, so these are different compounds isolated from different plant products. So now coming to chemotherapy, it is the treatment or control of cancer using chemicals, and depending upon their mechanism of action, chemotherapeutic drugs are classified as alkylating agents, anti-metabolites, anti-tumor antibiotics, mitotic inhibitors, hormones, and there are some compounds which are not coming in any of these categories. So these are some of the plant-derived chemotherapeutic drugs used in clinics. Vinblastine, it is isolated from this plant periwinkle. This camptothecin, it is isolated from the happy tree or cancer tree. This is the plant. And etoposide isolated from wild mandrake plant. And paclitaxel is a compound, and both docetaxel, another compound. Both these compounds are isolated from the plant Pacific Yew or Taxus brevifolia. It is isolated from the bark of this plant. So to treat one patient, it will need around around three plants, and one plant to grow to a fully grown tree, it will take 100 years. That's why this plant is very costly. Not plant, the drug. So we all know that after chemotherapy, almost everybody gets some side effects. Okay, so why it is happening? The chemotherapy works, you know, we cannot kill only just the cancer cell. It is impossible to select a cancer cell and kill it. Then what these drugs are doing? They are targeting the rapidly dividing cells. We know that cancer cells grow and divide very fast, and there is an uncontrolled proliferation for cancer cells. Okay. So this all the chemotherapeutic drugs will kill the rapidly dividing cells. So when we take a chemotherapy, all the cancer cells will die, because these compounds will kill the rapidly dividing cells. But there are several normal cells in our body which also divide very fast. Okay, that is the cells of the hair follicles and our digestive tract, immune cells. All these cells also divide very fast. And when we take a chemotherapy, all these cells also will die. That means we will have hair loss, fatigue, loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting. All these are the side effects of chemotherapy, because this chemotherapy kills the normal cells of some of the normal cells of our body. Okay. Okay, so if we are thinking that, okay, so we will reduce the amount of the drug being given, so that we can reduce the toxicity. Then what is happening is that cell undergoing chemotherapy will get drug resistance. Okay, that is the another drawback of chemotherapy. So if you don't give adequate amount of the drug, that cell will get resistant to that drug. Okay, that means some of the
Madam, you got muted. You got muted, madam.
Hello, ma'am.
Ma'am, your mic is muted.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Oh, maybe I clicked, something happened. So, from where I have to start again? Chemoresistance?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, when we give chemotherapy, and if the amount is not adequate, that cell will get chemo resistance. Okay. So that one of the cell will survive. If one or two cells survive, they are called cancer stem cell like. Okay. So these cells will then get, this resistant cell will get expanded and differentiated. So this will be very resistant cell. So there will be a therapeutic resistance. Okay. So then we will get a relapse of tumor. That means again that cancer, after chemotherapy, after some time, again that cancer will occur. Recurrence and relapse to tumor. Okay, and this will be very much resistant to the previous chemotherapy used. We have to use another drug for that. Okay. So at this condition, there is a process called chemosensitization. That means enhancement of the action of one drug by the presence of a second drug. Okay, this is either natural or synthetic. This is called chemosensitization. That means we are reducing the survival signals. We are blocking the survival signals induced by the conventional drug, chemotherapeutic drug, using a non-toxic compound. This compound may not be able to kill the cancer cells by itself. Okay, at that concentration use. But when we use this this compound before the drug treatment, what we can sensitize these cancer cells by reducing the survival signals induced by this compound or the cancer cells. And we can induce cytotoxicity by our drug at a lesser concentration. This is called the process of chemosensitization. Some drugs, while having no direct ability to kill cancer cells, appear to heighten the cancer cells' vulnerability to other drugs. This is the process of chemosensitization. Curcumin is a very good chemosensitizer. Resveratrol, isolated from the grapes, and EGCG from green tea, ginger oil. Green tea itself is a very good chemosensitizer. So in our lab, we are primarily focusing on identification of anti-cancer principle from plants widely available in Kerala and investigating their chemotherapeutic, chemopreventive, or chemosensitizing efficacy and the mechanism of action in cancer cells of cancers of different origins. That is the work being done in my lab. So, how to isolate these compounds? So, we usually shade dry the plant parts, either it is the leaf or fruit, whatever is reported to have the anti-cancer principle, we do that, a shade drying, not to lose the temperature by the activity by temperature. We shade dry them, then we do a polarity graded extraction. First non-polar solvent, like that we increase the polarity of the solvents, then finally, we get the maximum polar solvent. Then all the extracts we do the evaporate and we dissolve in DMSO or something. And we do a in vitro cytotoxicity assay. That means we put this drug in cancer cells growing in the laboratory conditions. Okay, they are viable cancer cells. And in the control, we won't put the drug, and in the treatment plate, we will put the drug. If there is a cell number difference, a cytotoxicity in the drug treated, this is a preliminary bioactivity assay. Okay. Then we will do other experiments, animal experiments and all. First experiment is this in vitro cytotoxicity assay. Then there are some other in vitro. In vitro means within the lab. In vivo means within the animal, okay, animal or human, whatever, all are in vivo animal experiments. Okay, that is how the starting of the screening of a compound for anti-cancer activity. Then if the compound is very active, we will put in normal cells also. For example, you are putting different cancer cells, that this compound we are putting in cancers of different origin, lung cancer, skin cancer, like that. Okay, breast cancer, oral cancer. So let us see that if a compound is very effective against skin cancer, then you have to put that drug, not that concentration, at least 5 times that concentration of that drug in normal skin cells. If it is skin cancer, normal skin. Liver cancer, normal liver cells. You have to put that drug. Okay. Then if that cell also is dying, for example, if I put 10 microgram of a compound, the cancer cells are dying. The same amount, if I put in normal liver cells, then that also is dying. Then that is not a drug. It is a poison. If you put potassium cyanide also, cells will die, right? So then that is not a drug. So there should be a variation between the cells, you know, the cytotoxicity in normal and cancer cells. Then only it can be considered as a drug. Then we check, the second step is checking the activity in animals. For that, we inject it either in, if it is a mouse cancer cell, you can inject that mouse cancer in mice. But if it is a human cancer, usually what we have is almost all our cells are human cancer cells. We put in vitro systems. Then you have to inject it in mice having immune deficiency. If you are injecting a human cell into a normal mice, it will not grow because that mice, there is a barrier. Okay, animal to animal barrier, it will not develop. It will be rejected by the immune system of that animal. So we have to use immune compromised mice like NOD SCID mice and all. Okay, this is a SCID mice. So yeah, we inject the cancer cells to its daughter cell area. Okay, then we give the drug intraperitoneally or IV like that to these animals. One group will be kept as positive control without giving any treatment. So if that in the treatment group, if the tumor is reduced or tumor is not developing, that drug has activity against that specific cancer. Yeah, these are different modes of administration. This is dorsal on the side of this animal. This is oral for oral cancer and all, we inject it orally on the tongue or somewhere. This is tail vein. You can, if for metastatic studies, we use a tail vein mode of cell injection. If you inject here, that tumor will go, that tumor cell will go to distant parts. Most probably we will get a lung tumor. Okay. So this is a drug treatment. Okay. So if this is controlled, no drug is given. So the tumor is growing fast. Okay. This is just to compare the size of the treated and untreated. This is treated one. Okay. We don't see much tumor here. Only on surgery we get the tumor. The next one is that there will be clinical trials. First will be a safety analysis, then expanded studies. There will be different phase one, phase two, phase three. So many trials will be there. So these are different compounds studied in our lab. Okay, the most studied compound in our lab is curcumin, okay, isolated from turmeric. And we have studied it as a chemosensitizer and as a chemo preventive. If you put some 25 micromolar curcumin in vitro, in cancer cells, growing in any cancer cell growing in the lab, almost all cells, not almost, every cell will die. Okay, 25 to 50 range. All cancer cells will die if you put it in this human cancer cell. Then why we cannot use curcumin as a drug, a chemotherapeutic drug? The reason is that this plant is not, you know, this compound, this curcumin is not soluble in aqueous media, and it is a non-toxic compound. So you can give, if human trials have checked it up to 9 grams per day in a human, but still after taking the drug, after 3 hours, if you check, or any time, if you check the blood, maximum is three hour time. If you check, you will get 5 micro in the serum. The bioavailability will be 5 micromolar. That means you will never get a concentration, a serum concentration of 20 to 25 micromolar of curcumin, however curcumin you eat. So you cannot use curcumin as a chemotherapeutic drug because you cannot maintain that serum concentration of curcumin as 25 micromolar. So whatever is available will be 5 micromolar maximum. So we checked whether this curcumin can be at this 5 micromolar curcumin. There is no meaning if you do so many, if you check curcumin in vitro studies, so many studies, around 2000 studies have shown that curcumin is very effective against that drug, that cancer, this cancer. Everything will be in vitro. Okay, all cells will die, that is true. But you will not get a cytotoxicity in vivo. There are so many clinical trials conducted in India and outside foreign countries, US and all, so many studies have done, but the clinical trials using curcumin alone are not successful because of this low bioavailability of curcumin. So we checked whether this 5 micromolar curcumin can act as a chemosensitizer with some conventional chemotherapeutic drug. These are all papers from that. The first paper is from my first PhD student. Here she has used curcumin with paclitaxel for cervical cancer. So 5 micromolar curcumin with 5 nanomolar Taxol can produce the effect of 10 nanomolar Taxol. That means you can reduce the toxicity of the Taxol chemotherapy to half, and curcumin is a non-toxic drug. Like that. Okay. So, and we have checked that in breast cancer. And different, I will show all those results. Okay. So these are the different compounds we have studied in our lab. And this is the last one we identified. This is Utroside B. This is the one we have patented. And it has got a FDA approval as a chemotherapeutic drug against liver cancer. So turmeric, I have already told. So you see, it will kill all cancers. Okay. But the problem is it alone cannot kill cancers in vivo within the body. This is the first work, Taxol plus curcumin. And this is Srikanth. He continued that work in animals. So you can see this is a cervical cancer formed. But when you give the combination, see the size of the tumor. This is the control. This is the drug treated. And this is breast cancer chemotherapy, curcumin 5-FU treatment. So the Harida and Vinod, he identified it in vitro system. Harida and Vinod did it in vivo system. We can see that when you use the combination, the tumor size will be drastically reduced. And this is another tumor model. Mammary carcinogenesis model. Here also tumor development, you can see this is the control. So the tumor development will be reduced by the combination. So these are the different tumor size. You see the size in the combination, the tumor size is very much reduced. So here curcumin is used as a chemosensitizer. Actually, what the killer is always that chemotherapeutic drug itself. Here it is 5-FU, in the other case it was paclitaxel. But what is done by curcumin is down-regulating the survival signals induced by the cancer cells and by the conventional drugs. The conventional drug, when they can induce some survival signals at lower concentration. That is why we have to use higher concentration of the drug. So before treating, if you are suppressing that survival signals induced by that conventional drug, we can use lower concentrations of the chemotherapeutic drug. So these are the other organs. For that breast cancer, we used other organs. You can see this is control animals. Okay. So in the treated, this is a splenomegaly. You see the spleen is very much enlarged in the case of the, this is control, this is curcumin, this is 5-FU alone, this is the combination. It will get the normal color, texture and size. Okay. So this is lungs, this is liver. So we checked whether, you know, I told you it the bioavailability and retention is less. So we checked whether curcumin by nano encapsulation can enhance the retention. Okay, tissue retention and the bioavailability. So we made it soluble also. Curcumin was insoluble. You see, this is curcumin suspended in water. Okay, this is curcumin suspended in DMSO. DMSO, it is soluble, but you cannot inject DMSO to a human being or animal. Suddenly that person will die. Okay, so you cannot give. So in vitro study, you can administer the curcumin in DMSO, but in vivo study, you cannot do that. This is nano encapsulated. This is almost, it's not soluble. It is dispersed, not like this. Here it is suspended in the bottom. But it is dispersed. And we could see that it can enhance the activity. Arun did that work. Archana and Arun did that work. So they could see this is the combination. Okay, this is the control. This is curcumin alone. We don't find much difference between control and the curcumin alone treated mice. But when you give the combination, we can get the See, this is the combination. You see the curcumin alone. We don't find any difference with curcumin. That's why curcumin alone treatment fails. We don't find any difference. But when you see the combination, okay, so it is reduced. This work is published in OncoTarget. And we checked whether curcumin can prevent the nicotine-induced survival signals. And we found that curcumin can inhibit the proliferative signals induced by nicotine and the benzopyrene-induced lung carcinogens, curcumin. Okay, so the number of nodules was reduced in the lab. Here we curcumin was given orally, not as injection. Okay, here also we checked whether nano encapsulation can enhance. We found that if you give orally the nano curcumin, the activity is better. Okay. This work was published in Cancer Prevention Research. Then this is resveratrol. Here also, like curcumin, it has several. This compound has several efficacies, and we found that the docetaxel, another compound from isolated from the this Taxus brevifolia plant, we found that curcumin, this docetaxel. This is 5 nanomolar docetaxel, but here we can see this 1 nanomolar docetaxel plus resveratrol. This is also a non-toxic. It is much more effective, inducing more cytotoxicity than 5 nanomolar docetaxel. So we can reduce the cost and toxicity of the docetaxel chemotherapy. And this was found to be very effective in HER2 overexpressing. You know what is HER2? For example, a breast cancer, when a person is detected with breast cancer, the first thing doctors will ask is the receptor status of that breast. Okay, some will be ER positive, estrogen receptor will be, which it will be having a lot of estrogen receptors. Then it is good actually. You can use, there are several drugs which can target this receptor. Okay. Some will be PR, progesterone receptor. Okay, PR positive. Some will be HER2 new. That is another receptor overexpressing. And some will be triple negative. That means none of these receptors will be overexpressing in this breast cancer. It will be very difficult to treat triple negative breast cancer. And we found that our combination, this 5-FU curcumin combination was found to be most effective in triple negative breast cancer. Next is another compound. This is triptandrin. This was a compound we isolated from a plant, Rhytia tinctoria. Okay, Rhytia tinctoria, in Malayalam it is called Dandapala. Okay, so several studies have been reported on various activities of this plant. Okay. It is used, this plant is used as a medicine for psoriasis. Okay, it is already reported. Some American company have patented also an extract of this compound, this plant from in against psoriasis. And it is our, from our, we found the first report on the anti-cancer activity of this plant, this compound, triptandrin. I mean, this plant, the Rhytia tinctoria, first anti-cancer report is out from our lab. This Jayesh isolated the compound. Jayesh and Meenakshi together did the anti-cancer activity screening of triptandrin. See, we found that triptandrin is very effective against melanoma. Okay, melanoma is a type of skin cancer. So we checked both types of drug administration, intradermally and intraperitoneally. In both cases, it was effective. So this is actually to see the size, we do the fluorescence labeling of the cells were luciferase transfected cells. You can see this is control, it is fluorescing all these areas. This is triptandrin treatment. Okay, this is control, this is treatment, this is control, this is treatment. Different sets of it. And Shabna completed that work. The mechanistic evaluation was done by Shabna. You can see, you see the control. It is almost all organs of this animal are fluorescing. Okay. But in this case, it is very, so that means the metastasis was also inhibited by metastasis. What is metastasis? Is the transport of cancer from one part of the body to other part of the other parts of the body, other organs, distant organs. So triptandrin administration stops the transport of this cells to other distant organs. Okay. And we checked whether, Meenakshi did this work, whether triptandrin can act as a chemosensitizer for triptandrin, along with triptandrin for melanoma chemotherapy. Melanoma chemotherapy, the drug used is dacarbazine. And along with the dacarbazine, when we use triptandrin, you see the size of the tumor was reduced, much reduced. So it can act as a chemosensitizer for melanoma chemotherapy. Now, triptandrin as a chemo preventive against non-melanoma skin cancer. I told you it is a multi-stage process, initiation, promotion, and progression. So we checked a DMBA-induced skin cancer model, whether triptandrin can act as a chemo preventive against development of skin cancer. Mohan did that work. You can see, you know, 6 weeks, 9 weeks, 12 weeks, you see the tumors developed. DMBA plus this PMA, it is a promoter. This is DMBA is an initiator. So twice we give, only two times we give DMBA, then continuously we give PMA, promoter. That initiation process is enhanced by the promotion, second step. Okay. So then during the promotion step, we give the triptandrin also in these animals. Okay, so this is the treated group. You can see the difference. So it can act as a chemo preventive. This paper is recently published in Cell Proliferation. And this is Lakshmi. She is a, you know, she has a different, she had a different background from all other PhD students joined in my lab. She is a pharmacology MSc. Okay, so she really wanted to find out new compounds. Okay. So she, this is a compound she isolated, camphorite. This is a compound she isolated from chromalina odorata. This is, you know, this plant is called communist pacha. Communist pacha. So in that one, from that she isolated a compound camphorite. This was found to be very effective. So this is the camphorite treated animals, cervical cancer. Okay, cervical cancer. We found that this compound is reducing tumor development. And we did the chronic and toxicity evaluation in animals. We checked, it did not produce any toxicity. So this is cervical cancer. One more and another. This is the, our most important invention that also Lakshmi did. So this was here, she isolated the compound called Troside B from this plant. This is the Solanum nigrum. It is called Manathakkali. Okay. So it shows, so this is the, from the leaves she isolated this compound. Okay. So this is a common plant growing like weed. In Tamil Nadu, and they use it for making curries and all. So it is a non-toxic plant. And in our Ayurveda literature, it has been used against liver-related diseases. So we checked the cytotoxicity of this compound in different cancers, and we found that it is inducing maximum activity against liver cancer. Okay, this is Gila cervical cancer. This is colon. This is skin. This is liver. Okay. So you can see these are different. This is, I told you, polarity graded extraction. We do first hexane extraction, then dichloromethane extraction, then ethyl acetate extraction, finally methanol extract. So methanol extract was found to be most active. So we concentrated here. This is liver cancer, FG2. We found that the IC50 of this compound was found to be 500 nanomolar. Okay. It was very potent drug. So there is only one FDA approved drug against liver cancer, that is sorafenib. Its IC50 is 5.8 micromolar, while Utroside B has an IC50 500 nanomolar. That's why this compound was taken by the American company. So this he's a chemist from NIST Trivandrum. He helped us in characterizing the structure of this compound, Dr. Ravi Shankar. So you see 500 nanomolar was the IC50. We again further screened in different cancers. Still it was maximum effective against liver cancer. Then liver, there are different types of liver cancers are there depending upon the HBV, HCV, like that. Okay. But we did not find any difference in any cancers. It was does not, it did not induce any difference between different HBV status. Okay. And we checked its cytotoxicity. This is Chang liver cell. It is normal liver cells. Okay. Normal immortalized liver cells. We found that the IC50 here, there is no IC50 up to 75 micromolar we have done here. But even up to 500, the IC50 here is 500 micromolar, while the IC50 here is 500 nanomolar. So I don't think there is any drug which has such a wide range between the normal and the cancer and normal counterparts. So it is highly non-toxic to normal liver. The tumor reduction study, actually we could not find tumors in the drug treated some of the animals. We did not find around 10 animals were taken for each group. So it was very difficult to find for doing some molecular work or some immunohistochemistry. You need some tissue, but in the drug treatment, we were finding it very difficult to some a small tissue from this uterocyte B treated animal. So these are the patent details. We got the US patent, we got the Canadian patent, and we have, and it, you know, it will be very difficult. At first I was feeling very sad to give this patent to a foreign country, but it is impossible for us to do this here, the clinical trial. First, we won't get a sanction. Second, we won't have money. Okay. Some $200 million these people are investing to make it into a drug. It's impossible for us to find out this much money. So I thought, okay, let us transfer the technology. At least some people will be benefited. Okay. So if it is not being made, it is not converted to a drug, nobody will be using it. And still, I just wanted to see whether it can be used to our people. By, we cannot spend this much money for a drug. So what I am doing is, okay, yeah, this one, this is a comparison, uterocyte B and sorafenib, cytotoxicity comparison. Uterocyte B is much better. We did an animal experiment also compared. See, this is uterocyte B treated tumors. This is sorafenib treated. This is much better. Now what I am doing is, anyway, uterocyte B, not like curcumin and triptandrin, uterocyte B is soluble in water. Okay, completely soluble in water. That means this leaf, we isolated from the leaf of this Solana nigrum, and Solana nigrum is a non-toxic plant. You can take, consume the plant as a curry. So what I am doing is, whether this, if you can take the IC50 concentration of the, that means how much plant, how much leaf is needed to make 500 nanomolar uterocyte B. That much leaf I am drying and powdering and making it as a capsule, and I'm giving to cancer patients and people having liver-related disorders. Okay, and we are finding excellent results to these patients. So many cancer patients and liver patients, other the fatty liver like diseases, people are joining in this trial. This is a trial. So that it will be, I will be somewhat relieved that this can be used by our people without giving any money. Okay, just to compare the activity. This is uterocyte B treated animals. This is leaf extract treated animal. You can give little more leaf extract, right? So that we can get a better result. This is exact corresponding value. That means this much uterocyte B, to get this much uterocyte B, this much leaf is to be given. That's how we calculate it. Since this is a non-toxic thing, we can give little more. So I think it is very effective. The study is still going on. And we checked the, we did not get a clinical trial sanction. Of course, we won't get in our country. So what we are doing is, we are doing as a toxicity evaluation. That means whether this is a plant being given by Ayurveda and naturopathy doctors as part of their treatment. So we are collecting their, we are giving these things free to these people, and we are collecting their blood. Okay. And we checked whether any of these patients are getting an elevated liver function. Okay. If a compound is really toxic, you will get the higher liver function result and kidney function result. Okay. Their creatinine level increase. And we have around 150 patients in the fatty liver group, and we have 12 people in the cancer patients group. None of the patients have got an elevated liver function, kidney function, or lipid profile is also effective. And the first patient is myself. Okay. I am taking this, I am a liver patient. Okay. Fatty liver. So I had a very high, my mother died of chronic liver disease. So when she died, actually that's how the whole thing started. My cousin, who is a naturopathy doctor, she told we give this manitakali to people. But I never tried this in my mother. Okay. When she was sick, this plant was there in my house. I never tried. I was scared to give. But now so many liver patients, and one of the security from our institute, he also had chronic liver disease. Now he is completely normal. He's telling me you should put my photo and tell everybody that I did not take the photo now. I have it. Okay, so his doctor had told more than you will not survive more than 3 years. Now he is taking 3 years. He's perfectly okay now. Okay, anyway, I could not give that to my mother. Now I am giving to so many people free. And we are finding, you know, very good activity. Even in liver cancer patients, they come to us in the last stage. Still, we are finding a reduction in their AFP level. Alpha fetoprotein is a indicator of liver cancer. We are finding a reduction in their AFP levels within 1 month itself. This is hepatic profile. Okay, alkaline phosphatase, we are getting it reduced in almost all cases. This is renal function. None of the people had a enhancement in their renal function means kidney function. So the lipid profile, some people had very good LDL level, triglyceride, all these things got reduced. And with this drug, this is the AFP level of liver at CC patient, hepatocellular carcinoma. You can see the reduction within 1 month. Okay. So it was actually this one, we were scared to start. A patient called Niranjan, he came to us from after seeing our paper, that Lakshmi's paper. He came to us from Bombay. He traveled here. He told, "Madam, I have this hepatocellular carcinoma. I am looking for a liver transplantation." So I did not get a liver to transplant. Okay. So till I get a liver, you should make me alive. So I told, "Be uterocyte B." He wanted uterocyte B. I told, "I cannot give you uterocyte B because I don't have a sanction for the clinical trial." So I told, we have a clinical trial on this leaf powder, which contain uterocyte B in the exact amount. So he took the plant, he took the powder, he took the capsule, the seeds, everything he took from us, and we gave everything to him. And I told you, after 1 month, you just try, check and let us say, you please send us your FP level. Then we will know what is happening to this plant. Only because he signed all the papers that I have no problem. It's with my wish I am taking like that. Within 15 days, he sent me a mail that, "Madam, 15 days checked, I got my AFP level reduced from 60 to 40. I'm so happy. After 15 days again, it came to 20. Like that. Okay. Then we don't know. After his transplantation, we don't know. He is not contacting us. I don't know. Maybe he's no more. I don't know. We cannot say that. But till that time, he was fine. This is his message, Niranjan's message. Okay. So he's telling, since April, my alpha fetoprotein levels were on the rise, and even 1 month after radiation, they won't subside. From a peak of 60, in a matter of 15 days of your trial, they have dipped to 45. Okay, like that. So we were so happy, but now we are trying to contact him. I don't know what happened to him. Maybe after his transplantation, I don't know what happened. Anyway, it was a hope. So with this, so many other people also joined. Some people, of course, some of them are, they have died, but you know, none of them had a higher level than what they joined in our study. That is for sure. In all our cases, it was slightly reducing. It did not increase after taking our medicine. So anyway, this trial is going. We are just conducting it for our own peace. Okay, I told you this place, the compound is already sold. I cannot sell it anymore. So this it is already transferred. The technology is already transferred to the US company. Still, it is a, you know, maybe one time it will become a drug. Okay. So there, I got a travel award from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to present this work in Brazil. And This is the transfer. QBiomed, they took this. They have started advertising because they have given us money right into our institute. So they are advertising it. This is their site. They were cancer. They are so we got this is the first milestone payment they gave. This is our previous director. And you see, this is FDA approved drug. We got RGCB got the license. Okay, so this is our collaborator in Oklahoma Research Foundation. They are interested, very much interested in clinical evaluation of this compound. He is the director of this Oklahoma Research Foundation, Dr. Riel Toner. So this is the study. These are the, you know, I have 2 more years of service. The further studies of Otrocide B is also going on, the mechanistic evaluation. And we are finding it very effective against breast cancers also. So we are further continuing the study there also. And triptandrin as a drug for psoriasis also we are studying. Like, so this is my group. This was my first student, first group when I started the lab. This is Smita, Vinesh, Srikant, Vinod, and this is the final group. Okay. So this is Kirtana, my last student, Regenia, Shweta, Lakshmi, this is Lakshmi, this is Meenakshi, Jayesh, Shabna, Harita. So this is my group. Okay. Thank you. I hope you could follow me. Thank you very much. Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. It was very excellent. And moreover, it's clear enough to express its meaning and useful also.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. Now, anybody has any doubt or somebody?
Yes. Now, the session is open for Q&A. Please type your questions in the chat box or else you can use the raise hand option. And actually, Sibu sir, Dr. Sibu Simon has a question. He has a question.
Okay. Thank you, madam, for your excellent talk.
Thank you.
So normally in Kerala, we always say that curcumin is good for cancer.
It is a good chemo preventive. If you continuously take curcumin,
yeah,
you can prevent the promotion stage of cancer.
But I mean, you mentioned that it is a chemo sensitizer.
As a chemo preventive also, I have shown, right? Benzopyrene-induced lung carcinogenesis. It is a very good chemo preventive. I take curcumin every day in milk.
Okay.
That means it can induce apoptosis to to cancer cells. Okay. So once a cell is damaged, either our body has a system to repair it.
Okay.
So it can be repaired by the body. So if a person is really healthy, it will be repaired. And if that damage is irreparable, the cell will commit suicide. That is apoptosis.
Okay.
You don't want to divide and make a tumor clone. Mm-hmm. It will commit suicide.
Okay.
And curcumin can induce this apoptosis process to damage cells. If we continuously take curcumin, these damaged cells produced in our body will be died. So it can act as a chemo preventive so that it will not be developed to a fully grown tumor. In chemotherapy, it can be used only as that means if you are detected with a cancer, you cannot treat it with curcumin alone. That's what I told.
Okay.
In patients.
Otherwise,
it is good to take. It can act as a chemo preventive.
Okay. And in the beginning of your talk, you mentioned that this called Lakshmi Taru.
I have not conducted any study with Lakshmi Taru. But so many people are telling it is good. I don't know.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Okay.
Ma'am, Dr. Jenny Jacob, head of the department.
Yes, ma'am. Dr. Ruby, it was a big eye-opener for me because I am very fascinated with medicinal plants. So my PhD work was also in anti-inflammatory. So, and the very fact that you are trying it as a treatment itself, like the Solanum nigrum.
Yeah, yeah.
So, is there any toxicity related to using that drug?
I showed the checked the activity, the cytotoxicity in normal liver cells and normal animals also. Check the liver parameters, everything. Okay, in normal liver cells also we checked. We did not find any toxicity. And okay, I told you I am taking it for more than 3 years. I think there is no toxicity.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. One more question, ma'am. As far as Ayurveda is concerned, they have a system of explaining the effect of a medicinal plant as a synergy.
Yeah.
Like you have a group of phytochemical compounds, they have some amount of synergy with each other.
Yeah.
Have you seen something like that when you're going for chemo preventives or chemo sensitizers?
Chemotherapy, we are finding a synergism with curcumin with a conventional drug. Not with several other products. I have not tried. I have tried one chemotherapeutic plus one natural product. Not different natural products. I did not try.
Try that. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Ma'am, there is one question in the chat box. That is whether this manitakali can be used against gastric ulcers.
It is used. It can be. It can reduce the gastric problems. Some of the participants of this study had severe gastric problem. So they are telling they started to reduce their liver function. But they are telling they got that gastric problem is completely gone. So now they are taking to reduce their gastric problem.
Ma'am, I have a doubt that you told me that this curcumin is bioavailability is very low. Is there any advanced techniques or methods to increase the bioavailability?
That's how we check this, that nano formulations.
Okay. And if it increases the sustainability also.
Yeah. It can reduce from 3 hours to 12 hours, the retention can be increased. We have published a paper on that.
Thank you, ma'am.
Biofactors and cancer chemo prevention, cancer prevention research.
Yes.
It is an ASR.
Another question is also there. That is, can we use black seed for cancer as we use turmeric?
I don't know. I have not tried.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. There is another question from Deepthi Suresh Kumar, that is, broccoli, cabbage, cauliflower, etc. contain glucocorticoids, which can fight cancer in many ways. So how much we can be prevent cancer by including these vegetables in our diet?
All these plants are used as chemo preventives. Okay, almost all plant products have chemo preventive efficacy. If you take continuously clean plant, it should be without any pesticide. That is very important. Okay, I can tell you one thing. When I took my mother to this an Ayurveda doctor, okay, he's very famous, a traditional Ayurveda, very old person. So she was having a allopathy treatment also. But when I took her, I was feeling she liked beef very much, beef. She used to eat beef. So I told is it because she took beef, she got the liver cirrhosis? But he was telling, he was a Brahmin. So he told, you know, among my liver cancer patients, women, most of them are andarjanas. Andarjana means, you know, Brahmin ladies. So they never take beef. Okay, so that means they are taking this, vegetables, they are buying the vegetables, they are taking it. So liver cancer is majorly produced by pesticides, because liver is our purifying organ, right? So whatever we eat, whatever things we eat, all the toxin will go to the liver. That's how it, okay. So from that day onwards, I stopped buying vegetables from outside. In my house, there is a rooftop. We don't have much space in Trivandrum. So in my rooftop, I made a rooftop vegetable garden. All vegetables, even today, I never take, only some potato, onion or something we buy from outside, nothing else. Maybe that's why I'm still surviving. I don't know. So many people from my mother's family died of liver disease. So maybe it is some hereditary thing also maybe there, but the doctor is telling nothing is there. We checked all the available hereditary tools, nothing is there because of this pollution. Maybe more, some people are more prone to some type of pollutions. So maybe we are prone to liver pollutions. Maybe that is the reason.
Other questions in the chat box. One more question is there from Dr. Blessen George. Okay. Is utrocide effective against cancer's metastasis to liver, or is it that it effective only against primary liver cancer?
No, we are finding metastasis also we checked. It is inhibiting metastasis also.
Hello.
And the I could not hear.
I think it was a mistake, ma'am.
Okay.
That's all. We have the questions in chat box. If anybody want to ask any questions, please type in the chat box or else we can close the question and session. Ma'am, there is one more question. That is, what diet can be advisable for cancer patients?
Any type of cancer, you are telling.
It's a general question, I think, ma'am.
Yeah, cancer patients, definitely they should undergo treatment, right? Whatever the doctor is telling. Plus, definitely non-toxic food. If you take, that is good. Okay. So generally, I cannot tell what type of reduce the fatty food. Yeah, can take leafy vegetables. Can take turmeric. Can take anything without contamination. I mean pesticides.
Okay, ma'am. Now she specified that it is for ovarian cancer. If it is ovarian cancer.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling. Fatty food she should that person should avoid fatty food. Definitely that person should take definitely chemotherapy or whatever treatment. Okay. After getting cancer, you cannot stop the cancer just by food. Definitely you should undergo treatment. The other, all these plant products are used as preventives to avoid the development of cancer. Otherwise, it can be used only as a sensitizer. Along with that, you should take a chemotherapy or any other treatment, a type of treatment. Okay. Ovarian cancer is due to some hormonal imbalance will be also there. So definitely it should be taken care of.
Ma'am, there is another question from Dr. Salim Jose. He's asking whether there is any role of Annona muricata fruit in cancer.
I don't know.
And there is another question from Dr. Soumya Madhavan. And she would like to appreciate you first for the excellent talk. And other than, and she is asking, other than plants, have you checked any mushrooms, its anti-cancerous properties?
No, I have not checked.
So I think we can go forward.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you. I was audible, right? The presentations was
yes ma'am. Yes,
you could
ma'am.
See also, right?
Okay. Yes, perfectly well.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the next presentation. And I request Mr. Ajay Kurian for to deliver the vote of thanks.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. Let me start with an apology because my webcam isn't working properly, so you might miss my face. But anyway, I'm fortunate that the microphone works at least. So without further delay, let me come to my duty. First of all, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to our chief speaker, Dr. Ruby John Ando from the Division of Cancer Research, Rajiv Gandhi Center for Biotechnology. Thank you so much, ma'am, for accepting our invitation and sparing your valuable time to become the chief speaker at this webinar. This was indeed a thought-provoking session for all the participants, and you can see the results here because there were a number of questions from the participants. Thank you so much once again, ma'am.
Thank you.
I would like to thank our dear principal, Father Dr. Churyanjay Kote, for his support and guidance in the smooth conduct of this webinar series. I would also like to extend my warm regards to our administrator, Professor Varghese Abraham, for his support and guidance in the smooth conduct of this webinar. As you all know that we have been conducting this webinar series since 20th May 2021. With a number of prominent scientists, researchers and academicians as our chief speakers. So we have received nearly 400 registrations, not only from Kerala, but also from Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Lucknow, Bhopal, Delhi, West Bengal, Haryana, etc. And we have got a number of international participants from Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Scotland, the US, Singapore, Argentina, Dutch Republic, etc. So success doesn't come that easy. It takes a lot of hard work and systematic efforts of a team. There are a few names which I would like to mention, and it will be a terrible mistake if I didn't mention their names. I would like to congratulate Professor Beena Churyan, Dean, School of Biosciences, for a significant contribution to make this webinar series a grand success. Thank you, Beena ma'am. I would like to thank Dr. Jyotish Kumar Parameshwaran Pillai, Research Director, MacFirst, for his valuable support and guidance. Thank you, sir. And there is an important name which I will never miss, and that is none other than Dr. Jenny Jacob.
Yes, Ajay. I think we lost Ajay. Ajay, hello? Ajay, we can't hear you. Hello, Ajay. I think he has lost his connection. So in the meantime, we have our administrator with us. Varghese sir, a few words from you, sir.
Thank you, Jenny. You have done a wonderful work by doing continuous webinars for the last 11 days and last very beautiful. Thank you, ma'am. I'm a person from the finance background, but still I enjoy many things you have been mentioning about the cancer treatment and its work. Thank you, ma'am, for your presence today. I also want to congratulate the Department of School of Bioscience and all the staff members of School of Bioscience, especially the seminar coordinator, Sibu Simon, and the HOD, Dr. Jenny Jacob. The students of the department get a very valuable enlightenment on these days by participating in this seminar. I hope they will work on this and find out with the new avenues of research backgrounds. Thank you, everyone. Once again, from the part of management, I congratulate the department and every faculty members for beautifully organizing such a wonderful webinar and providing an opportunity for our college to be visible in more than one country. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
So thank you, Vagi sir. I think Ajay's connection was gone. He'll join back in soon. So
you may conclude with part of that.
Yes, yes, sir. I think in the meanwhile there was one question for in between. For Ruby madam. Hello, Ruby madam, are you there? Hello? I think she is not there. Right.
So, okay. Maybe we can continue with the valedictory function, no? We can continue then.
Yes, we can continue, but Ajay hasn't come back, I think.
Okay, ma'am. We can continue with...
He said he will join back, but... can we wait 2 minutes?
Hello, can I leave?
Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your presence.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay. Yes, Ajay. Yes, he's back.
Yes, I'm back. I'm sorry for the unfortunate incident.
It's okay. It's okay. Please continue.
Yeah, I was talking about you. So, you know.
Maybe that is why the connection went off.
I don't know. You've shown us the true spirit of a great leader. That's what I was trying to say. You know, you are trying to become a great leader by constantly motivating and guiding your team, you know, which not only includes the faculty members, but also the students of School of Biosciences. And thank you so much, Jenny ma'am, for setting up a new and fresh example of a true leader. Thank you so much. And then we have got a program coordinator who doesn't give up to any challenge that is put in front of him. That's none other than Dr. Sipu Simon. He, along with Dr. Smita Vijayan and Dr. Teresa Verghese, has coordinated this webinar series. Even though the program was done in association with IQSE, none of them have disturbed me at any stage. So congratulations for the coordinating team, and we are indebted to you for making this program a grand success. And I would also like to thank and congratulate each and every members of the faculty team, student coordinators, and other people who have made their contributions throughout these webinar series. Thank you so much, faculty members and students. And we have got an important category of people that we should thank. That's none other than the participants of this webinar series. You guys are indeed the key to success. So I would like to express my sincere gratitude to all our participants. And without you people, this would have been possible. So thank you so much, everyone. Stay safe and stay happy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, I would like to invite Professor Beena Charyan, Dean, School of Bioscience, MacPherson, to address the audience.
Respected Principal, Reverend Father Dr. Charyan Jekoti, our Administrator Professor Verghese Abraham, Research Director Dr. Jyotish Kumar, Dr. Jenny Jacob, Head of the Department, Dr. Sibu Simon is Program Coordinator, delegates, dear colleagues, students, and all participants. The time has come to draw a curtain to our brainstorming international webinar on current trends in molecular life sciences. A very good evening and a warm welcome to all of you to this session. I would like to recall a famous quote from eminent scientist Dr. William Thomas Asbury. We are at the dawn of new era, the era of molecular biology, as I like to call it, And there is an urgency about the need for more intensive application of physics and chemistry, and especially of structure analysis, that is still not sufficiently appreciated. Last 90s, we got deep insights into several topics on molecular life sciences, which were delivered by eminent speakers of national and international repute, enlightening us to reflect on the basic aspects as well as the recent advances in molecular life sciences. We were fortunate enough to have eminent speakers like Dr. Peter Mathavi from Sweden, Dr. Alagraj Velchami from US, Dr. Katsusna Retzer from Czech Republic, Dr. Sylvia Strutt from Belgium, Dr. Teraga Ramji Moturu from Belgium, Professor Jeju Ray, Professor G.M. Nair, Dr. Hari Kumar, and Dr. Ruby Jung. All these sessions, they were highly informative and beneficial for us. The planning and preparation for the webinar did not happen overnight. So it was the effort and hard work put forth by the whole MacFirst community, especially Dr. Sibu Simon's program coordinator, Dr. Jenny Jacob, head of the department, Dr. Smita Vichayan, Dr. Teresa Ogis, and the whole bioscience faculty. So I appreciate and also to congratulate each and everyone for providing all sorts of support throughout the webinar. So our research director, Dr. Jyotish Kumar, he deserves a special word of thanks. So he has always shown keen interest in our activities and rendered great strength and support to all the programs we undertake. So we gratefully mention the support rendered by the management of MacFirst, headed by our principal, Dr. Chiryanjay Kotil, and the administrator, Professor Verghese Abraham. So the success of any program that is mainly depends on the reputed speakers, delegates, faculty members, and students for their overwhelming participation. Once again, I congratulate each and everyone who had made this program a resounding success. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now I would like to invite Dr. Jyotish Parameswaran Pillai, Associate Professor and Research Director, MacFirst, to address the audience.
Sir, you are muted.
You can mute.
Yeah. So, respected principal, our beloved professor, Chiryanjay Kotil, respected administrator, our Verghese Abraham sir, respected dean, Professor Beena Chiryan, our head of the department, Professor Jenny Jacob, Professor Shibu Simon sir, Dr. Smita Verghese, Smita Vijayan, and all other faculty members. All our faculty members and students and the participants. So good evening all. So first of all, I would like to thank all the speakers for their wonderful lectures. So we have renowned speakers from across the globe. And I would like to thank all the speakers for accepting our invitation and for your time and for your excellent lectures. In fact, I am not a biology man, but I could understand what this lecture is all about. In fact, the lectures are, in fact, the other people, even a plastic man like me could understand all the lectures. So unlike this lecture series is truly world-class. We have renowned speakers from across the globe. I would congratulate our HOD, Professor Jenny Jacob and Professor Shibu Simon for all your commitment and your efforts for organizing this wonderful webinar. I would also like to thank the participant and speakers, participant and students, and to make this event memorable. And you know, it should be pointed out that I have been in many international webinars, but the attendance of this webinar series is approximately around 250 to 300 on an average. So this makes this conference series a huge success. And I hope we can collaborate with all the speakers, and hopefully we can have joint conferences with our institute and the speakers institute. And also hopefully we can have joint books, joint collaborations, joint student exchange programs with our institute and you know, with the speakers institute. And hopefully we can have extend to the next level. So anyway, congratulations to all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I invite Dr. Sibu Simon, program coordinator of this webinar, to propose a word of thanks.
Okay, so very good afternoon to all. So it's already, it's quite a lot of word of thanks here. And probably it is not that appropriate to repeat it again, the same thing. So I will, generally what I can say is that we are generally very happy. The webinar performed beyond our expectations. So we all are happy. And it was really a group effort. It was an effort from different sector of people. Of course, principal was there. Our chief administrator was there for support us. Jenny Miss was constantly in touch. She was giving us always right instructions at right time. It was not only about instruction, she was also doing something for herself, spending her time, valuable time for doing something. Then, of course, we know that Bina Madam, we all are well aware about her cordial nature. When I mentioned her that we are conducting an international webinar, immediately she offered any kind of support. So thank you, Madam. Then Jyotish sir is quite new, but you can see that he is actively participating in all the activities of our department as well as the general activities of our college. So thank you, sir, for your willingness to participate and willingness to support us. I would also like to thank all our speakers. It was an amazing set of speakers in terms of coming in time, joining in time, testing their presentation, and then they were maintaining very nice timing, and it was such a disciplined eminent speaker section. So thank you. Thanks to all the speakers. Then one thing I definitely stress is that the bioscience faculty members. So I am also quite new in the department, and it was a right occasion for me to understand the department. What is the nature of the department? I was approaching different faculties for something, and not a single person said no or any excuse for anything what I asked for. So thank you so much for making me realize what my department is. So it was such a wonderful response from you all. Ajay already mentioned that he didn't support us that well, but actually we didn't expect. We were actually expecting your emotional support, and we got it enough, and that was really a good support from you. Then definitely all participants, it was an exceptionally nice participant, number wise, and also you people are really very interactive. So stay the same, try to be interactive, and it was a really nice participation from all of you. Then we have a few student representatives. They were directly involved with the coordination of the webinar series. Aparna and Devika was comparing the sessions very beautifully. And then we had students from different batches to offer a vote of thanks. Thank you so much for your active participation and enthusiasm. Last but not least, I would like to mention Smita Vijayan. She is always staying a bit behind the curtain, but she was definitely very active. I mean, she was very active in all stages of the conductance of this webinar. And she was also actually inviting some speakers. So it was, overall, it was a very nice experience. Thank you so much for all your support. So probably we can wind up. Yeah, thank you. So you have the link. You have the link there. You can also give the feedback, and also you will be getting the participant certificate in the same link. So fill in the link, and then we can wind up.
Thank you, Varghese sir, for your presence.
Shall we wind up?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir.
So I have given the feedback link once more. Please remember to type your name correctly. Yeah, so your certificate will also come correctly. Okay.